Oh, thank you guys very much.
Wow.
That was awesome.
I'm glad you liked it. That was crazy.
Still crazy.
All right, so I just want to introduce myself real quick. I was the third captain of the, I'm not using that, I can, yeah. Can everybody hear me? Are we good?
Yeah.
All right, I was the third captain, the Missouri State chapter of the Flying Spaghetti Monster. And JT was the second. I don't know where, is JT here yet?
No.
Twitter and blogging.
He said he was going to be here like 2 hours ago.
Okay, that's cool. But anyway, we've been working on this movie for the past 4 years, as long as Skepticon's been going on. You guys have been a part of it the entire time, and it means so much that you come out and watch it tonight. So thank you very much for being here. Thank you. Usually I'm in the lion's den, because when we show this, it's like 90% Christians, and everyone gives me shit. Every time they ask me if I believe in God, so I'm just going to answer that real quick. No, I do not believe in God after the plane crash. And so with that being said, I hope the same questions go to the Christians. So, if you have any questions, we'd love to have them.
I just got to say, that's the most humanistic movie I've ever seen from two-thirds Christian group. I love it.
There's so much in this movie that talks about what you guys did as three human beings, individuals, and I didn't hear anything about Jesus getting credit for it or God getting credit for it. And even though I know that influences your worldview, the fact that you showed what three normal people could do just speaks volumes to me. I loved it. I absolutely loved it.
Thank you.
So how do you guys...
You get two now? Questions?
Yeah. All right, go ahead. How are you doing now? Because, I mean, you guys went through a hell of a lot, and you seem to be doing all right. Are things good with you now?
I'm very up and down. My head's still a little goofy from all that situation. It sneaks up on me, but it's less frequent than it was before. It's definitely kind of just changed how I feel about life and death. Some days it's good, some days it's bad. At first, after it, I really felt like the world was a much scarier place. And then through going through all the experience, I see that the world is a much more beautiful place because it is that scary. But yeah, I'd say I'm doing pretty good right now.
After I got surgery March 25th, 2010, they removed about 10 inches of my intestines. It took me about a month to recover, but since then I've been able to eat and hold stuff down, so I'm doing really well. I'm able to, the back injury doesn't really bother me. I'm able to run, exercise, you know, do manual labor, that kind of thing. So I feel really blessed that, you know, to be here and to be all right. I still have some issues, but irregularity is one way you might put this one.
He's barring like crazy.
It's interesting for me. My dad is big like into herbal cleanses and natural medicine. You know, we're not like a Christian scientist or anything like that. But I never got vaccinated for anything or took any malaria medicine. Yellow fever was mandatory in order to leave Kenya and go back, but I'd been to Kenya before without having any vaccinations. And throughout the whole 3.5 months traveling through 6 countries, I never got sick once, never had diarrhea once, never got malaria, anything. It was really strange. I like did the least to like try to like prevent everything from happening, and we got the least that happened to me.
His brother did get malaria though, so.
Yeah. Oh yeah, my brother, the cameraman, went with us. And he's actually an agnostic. He says that he doesn't know if there's a God, that he doesn't think we are ever capable of really understanding if there is or not. But I don't know, just last Friday I was talking to him, he said that he's been seeing God work in his life. And I was like, did that just come out of your mouth? Are you serious? So.
What do you think is the most effective thing that people in the West can do? Because like the conventional foreign aid system of, you know, where we give, like American government gives to governments there, doesn't seem to have worked very well. What would you think would be the better way to go about, you know, helping?
There's lots of good things you can do. For me, I was skeptical about everything, just the aid that had currently been giving. I didn't know if it actually worked. The one thing that when we studied it and kind of looked into it that just really hammered home for me, I was like, this is a good idea. It's something called Kiva.org, and it's basically funding microloans for people who, it's no interest loans, it's someone who wants to start a business in Africa or other foreign countries. They can apply for maybe $1,000 just to start their business, and then you can do a minimum of $25 donation to start that program. And then once they get that that amount of money through all of people donating to that, they have to pay it back within a certain amount of time. So it's really, they're accountable for the idea, and you can clearly see that it's working, and then you get your money back, and it's not a handout, so you can reinvest that. Interesting thing this year is I do the video work for Skepticon as well. And with the speaker's permission, what I'm going to do is I'm going to monetize those videos, and the revenue that comes from that, I'm going to directly purchase microloans with that. So Skepticon is going to be doing good things. So.
Yeah, definitely. Just the way that we go about helping people can actually hurt them more than it helps them, and can cause like paternalism and enabling instead of actually empowering. To where they're sustainable in the way that we help them, and there's definitely a lot of lessons that can be learned with the way that aid has been given, the way that it has hurt people. I mean, as a Christian, I would say that I believe the church is the best way, just because it's so important when you're trying to help someone to have someone on the ground, so that when you're helping them, it's through relationship, and I just believe that through a local church, which is pretty much everywhere in the world, you know, any Christian anywhere can plug into a church and have commonalities in believing in, you know, of the Bible and Jesus as their Savior, and they can automatically, you know, as we travel through six countries, just in every country, every city we went to, we always met Christians who were just like, hey, and like there's just this camaraderie between us, and to then say, you know, so you have a church with this many people and they have this, these kind of needs, like you are in contact with them, how can we help you help them, you know, just like through that relationship, I think is the best way to try to help someone.
And one thing that I like to say, like, I hope if anybody gets out of this film, everybody that shows this film to is ask themselves two questions. First, what breaks your heart? Like, was it something in this film? Was it HIV? Was it extreme poverty? Maybe it's the environment here in America. Maybe it's poverty here in America. Kind of figure out what it specifically tugs on your heart, and then ask yourself, what makes you come alive? Like, what when you do it, time just flies by, and it's a talent that's been praised in you. It's just something that you really get joy out of doing. So I ask those two questions. What breaks your heart? What makes you come alive? And put those two things together. Because I think, like, for me, it's what I love doing is making movies. And what breaks my heart is young people without a purpose. And so I try to put those two together with this film. So I think that's a really great way, because you can get overloaded with all the different issues and all the different things. And I think the best thing you can do, because guilt will fade. Guilt about, like, how much money you have and how much you can help those people. What will last is what breaks your heart and what you're good at. And I think stick with those two things.
I've been seeing stuff like that since I was little, just like, oh, send a dollar a day and it'll help. I'm like, does this actually help? And so one of the things we were brainstorming when we were figuring out the movie was, we should go meet this kid. We should go meet this kid that we're sponsoring. Dan was sponsoring a kid, has been since he went to Africa the first time, and he's going to tell you the story of how he went to go meet his kid.
Yeah, well, this little kid, when I went in 2005 in my church, I saw this little kid. He was like a bad little kid. He's always hitting all the other kids and stuff. And he's really cute. And then, like, when I came home, I had, like, these pictures of all these kids, and I saw that little kid. I'm like, I don't want that one. And so, for the last 6 years, I've been sponsoring this little kid named Vincent. And, you know, you kind of wonder, like, does my money really go to him? Like, I had a brand with an organization, and it was pretty grassroots, and I met the kid. So I felt pretty good about it, but when we returned, I mean, the kid had grown so much, and he was so healthy, and he obviously knew who I was. Like, I knew this was the guy that was helping him, you know, go to school and all this stuff. But he was really shy and really nervous, and we took him out, and we got some mango juice, you know? We're like, what do you want? He's like, I want mango juice. And I'm like, you want a big glass or a small glass? He's like, big. And I got him this glass. It was so huge. Like, I couldn't even drink it. And he, like, drank, like, that much. That was hilarious. The big one. But he was a cute little kid, and we actually kind of, we found out we kind of stole him, because, like, we thought we had permission, but you kind of don't know who's who, and, like, that was his uncle who gave us permission, so a lot of people calling us and stuff. I was like, where's the kid? And you stole our kid.
Mango trafficking.
Yeah, we're
I had to try.
I just have a question. So the first part, I guess, is did you drink, like, the local water all the time, or did you have filtered water? Because the movie kind of came off that you just drink, like, dirty water once. And the second part is, a big thing that I got from this was how bad the infrastructure was due to the illegality of a lot of the location, like, where people were living. Do you think that was that's a huge contributing factor to why, like, the roads aren't paved, or is that just everywhere?
Well, this is the first one. Yeah, we make it kind of look like we talk about change, man, because it makes it appear to that were just drinking the local water, but we were, but that water was boiled, and everything that we did drink was either boiled, or we had this thing called a SteriPen, and you could put it in the water, it's UV, and just add it for like 90 seconds and kill everything. So we never actually drank out of rivers or out of wells without doing something to treat the water.
It was dirty water, but it was like infected water.
Yeah.
So I can't
taste it.
Change that voice.
And there was some bacteria.
I don't ever drink the water. You're filling your brain.
All right, next question.
And then the infrastructure question. I would say a lot of it is about what I was talking about, the governments. You know, they're getting money to build up infrastructure. Instead, they're spending it, you know, amassing this great wealth and depriving the common people was a really big issue. One huge issue also is that, you know, African countries have only been free for like 50 or 60 years from colonial powers. And a lot of the colonial powers actually set up what's called monocrop economies and infrastructures that basically took the crop they were taking, like coffee or something, from like the center of the country and just took it all the way out to the ocean. So there wasn't infrastructure built for people to live. It was just infrastructure generally built, like trains and those kind of systems, built to take the wealth and extract it. So that there's a lot of leftover from colonial impact in that sense. So it's kind of that, you know, corruption. I mean, and Africa's massive. I don't know if you know, but like our typical map doesn't actually represent the actual size of Africa. There's something called the Peters map that better represents the geographical size, and Africa is just way more massive than it looks. You know, Greenland is like nothing like it is on the globe, and then like Africa is much bigger, and so it's a very vast area.
I know the two of you weren't able to really fulfill everything you planned to for the documentary, but is there anything the three of you did not get out of this that you had hoped to in the end?
Is there anything all three of us got out of it, or didn't get out of it that we hoped to, besides like the whole idea of not getting to go across Africa in a plane crash?
I got everything I wanted to get out of it, more. I didn't really have any expectations. I kind of just went along for the ride, so. There wasn't when I got home, I was like, man, I wish I would have dug a well. It was just like, man, I'm glad to be home from that place, you know?
Yeah, that's the first time I've ever been asked that.
Yeah,
question.
There was a part in the movie where I was like, you know, sitting in Grace's village, 100 people with no electricity, no river water. I was just like, this is exactly what I was hoping I would experience. So in many ways, I did kind of experience what I was hoping. I mean, you guys might not like this, but other than like just being along, you know, for the ride with Rob, just hoping to kind of see him and his relationship with God, that's something I was hoping for.
It's kind of, you kind of stole like half my thunder, you know, it's like everything, you know, besides Africa, it's like that was kind of everything I missed out on. Like when I started editing the film, David had about 60 hours of footage and I just saw all the places he went and all the beautiful things he did and just that experience I wanted. And like I wanted to know God better myself by experiencing suffering. But I thought it'd be like, you know, in Africa, the hunger, and like it'd be something totally different than what I did get. So I still got that too. Like I don't know. I can't think of anything.
Good question though.
Yeah. An Oscar.
There was some back here. That's Ben raising their hand a whole bunch. Yeah, this guy.
Yeah, how to keep your cameras from being broken or stolen or even charged up while you're hitchhiking?
Well, I have to charge up because that one's easy. McDonald's is pretty much the U.S. Embassy anywhere around the world, so anytime we could go get a dollar cheeseburger, we spent at least a dollar of our money, and we sat there for like 6 hours and charged there. It works.
And then not getting robbed.
There were a couple like pretty crazy things that happened. One, me and my brother Tim were on what they call a Voda, just a little motorcycle, with a third guy actually driving it, just a little dirt bike type of thing. The tire blew up, and so we're like squeezed on this motorcycle, and then it starts like wobbling, and so we start going one way, and we all lean the other way, and it tipped over and like kind of flipped. We were on this dirt road, maybe just going like 30 miles an hour, and we ended up sliding about 10, 15 feet, just kind of getting like, we had flip flops on, kind of got some bloody feet. Tim like rolled on the camera, and like we heard a big like crunch noise, Right. Oh, no, it's a wheel belly. It was just a little tape that like busted. And so yeah, and that was kind of like, oh, so glad that we didn't break our camera.
Our camera was actually, we shot a movie on that camera she's shooting right now. It's like that big.
We did lose our XHA-1, which was that big camera you saw, and the plane lost that snapper right in half, and then we lost one of the HB-30s, which I was holding in my hand. That's the footage that was recovered. The footage from the big camera was burned up, and we sent it to the NTSB to try and reconstitute it, but they never got back to it, so.
That's too bad. And then there's just one story. I personally thought that it'd be a lot more dangerous than it was. My brother Tim had to go ahead and meet up with Georgia Shoeman while I was still in the hospital with Dan. They had flown back, so I went to meet up with Tim and was supposed to take a bus around 4, but they just sat there until it got full, which I didn't, they don't run here, we're leaving exactly this time. So we didn't leave till like 8 or 9, and instead of getting there at like 10, we got there at like 2 in the morning. They dropped me outside of a bar in this little city in Western Kenya. So I'm standing there with a big backpack all alone in the middle of the night, trying to get a hold of my brother, trying to wake him up to figure out which place he's staying or how to get there. And these two drunk guys come out and they're like staring at me and like kind of looking at me, and they just started singing this song and dancing in the middle of the street for me. And I was just like, maybe it's so nice. Maybe this isn't as bad as I thought it'd be. It's dangerous. But there was one instance where there's a city called Mwanza, it means like city of boulders, and there's just a bunch of outcropping of rocks that me and Tim had climbed up. And like 5, 17, 18-year-old kids followed us up there while we were climbing on these boulders, and we were away from the city. And they kind of circled around Tim and started saying "camera" in Swahili, his camera. So we're like, okay, looks like these guys might want to rob us. And so we just started walking down the boulders, trying to get back around people. And I was behind Tim. He like went ahead, and they grabbed my book bag. And I turned around and yelled at this guy who had like 4 guys behind him. I just said, "Don't touch my bag," like pretty loud, and pointed at him. I turned back around, and he grabbed it and pulled me backwards. And I actually turned around and jabbed him in his neck with my hand. I go, and I yelled at him. I said, "Don't touch my back!" And he like, oh, he just like was stunned. I was like ready to say, "Go, maybe grab on." But they just stood there, and we just got out of there quickly. But other than that, some teenage kids kind of messed with us. We didn't have any issues of anything being stolen, any run-ins with anyone. Really, that was that scary or threatening.
Shouldn't we ask you something bad back here?
Yeah, I mean, this underscores the point that religious belief is neither necessary nor sufficient to getting involved in helping other people. And also, I would really ask, David, why did you cut your hair? Why are you not dating that beautiful Santa woman?
We wanted to hear your punch.
No, I'll give that second part. I've been to Malawi twice. I'll tell you a little bit about one of the saints. I went in March with my pastor and my father, and then I spent all summer, for the most part, alone in Malawi, Southeast Africa. We're building a rehabilitation center for teenage girls who are forced into prostitution and are victims of sexual exploitation. And our goal is by next summer to raise $125,000. So we acquired 3 football fields worth of land from the senior chief right outside of the city that is internationally known for being the place that grown men will go and sleep with young teenage girls. And the senior chief just gave us this huge plot of land for free and says we would love for this to come and be built here. And we just had our launch last Saturday. We started with a dessert banquet fundraiser for the organization, When the Saints Come Marching In. It's just whenthesaints.com. We raised $28,000 on like our launch. Launch that was pretty cool.
So it's like one of you like raised the whole movie to shoot with them.
David does it in one.
So anyway, in Malawi, I have my dreads. I had it for a year and 3 months. I just cut over the summer. Because in Malawi, they're like a lot less progressive in their thinking. They're like, I kind of picture them being like what America was like in the 50s, they're real conservative and only drug dealers have dreadlocks. And so like going and starting this ministry for prostitutes and having dreads was like not a good combo. So I had to cut them off. I wish that I still had them.
Yeah.
God has allowed all the problems that exist in your film to be in the first place, including the crash. Now, why isn't he already fixed?
Well, I would say, like, I think that's, you know, sometimes we go to churches and stuff and people are like, oh, God, you know, God saved you guys. Isn't that a miracle rescue? And Rob, you know, for Rob, it's like, well, what about the two pilots? You know, these are two guys whose lives are devoted to God, who have four kids each. You know, and so I think why bad things happen is often a mystery. But I would kind of rephrase that question and say, why do we find so much good stuff on the way? I mean, I know there's the problem of evil, but there's also kind of a problem of good, I feel like. Yeah, so that's my, you know, it could be all because of society, but I also think there's a lot of good things happening in the world, and I would flip that question.
I think what changed my perspective severely is, I mean, not that it was really much different, but when I went to Africa and interacted with people living in extreme poverty, I kind of talked about it, just the level of joy that they have, despite this immense suffering that they're going through on a daily basis, and just like how that doesn't, it just doesn't make any sense, it's so counterintuitive. You know, how can you experience so much suffering but have such a strong sense of community and interconnectedness and just invite a stranger in and just love as if we've known each other for our whole lives, and just how inspiring it is. And I started thinking about it, like, I was like, you know, in America, I'm telling these Africans, like, we're always wondering, like, there's, you know, there's so much suffering over here. It's because in Malawi and Eastern Africa, it's like 70-80% Christian, so I'm talking mostly to Christians, and I just say, you know, there's a lot of Americans who question the existence of God because of what you guys experience on a daily basis, and they're like, really? And like I'm explaining this to them, and in my head, they were so surprised. I was like, I wonder if, like, ever these people living in extreme poverty are, like, sitting around a table asking, like, you know, them each other, like, guys, I don't know if I can believe in God, because people in America are so incredibly wealthy, but they're like, such a, like, a depressed nation. They're on so many drugs, and like depression is so terrible, and like the divorce rate is so terrible. Like, I don't know if I can believe in a God that allows so much suffering to happen to people who are so wealthy. You know? So it's just like, man, experiencing and interacting with people living in extreme poverty is radically redefined what happiness is, and, you know, how someone can suffer so much but still have so much joy and such a deep relationship with God. So,
what do the charities in Africa do to help educate those people, make them mechanically inclined, to help themselves, to build water systems, to build things, to take care of those things, take care of themselves, and not have to rely on quote-unquote Christian charity all the time?
Yeah, I mean, just like from one of the things, you know, I'm in bringing, you know, I met a 15-year-old girl named Gladys. She was a prostitute for 2 years. She lost her parents at the age of 6. And so to get her off the streets and put her into an educational facility, like this rehabilitation center, and do counseling and train her in her vocation so that she can then, when she gets 18, or I plan on that, the program being about a year to 2 years. I don't want to keep them there for a really long time. But once they get some kind of vocational training to, like, let's say sew something, then they can go in and start a business sewing things in the market for people to make a living so that they're then, like, kind of like Kiva, you know, it's just empowering them to start a business, which will then strengthen the economy and allow them to make a living so that they're not, and some of them are, you know, choosing, they do choose to sleep with men, because Gladys told me, she was like, hey, if I want to eat today, I have to sleep with men. Like, she doesn't see any other option. So to empower them into another option so that they can go out and strengthen the economy to support themselves, that's...
Yeah, I think any good charity should be about empowerment. Like, Christian and non-Christian secular should all be about getting people, like, there's this great quote you said that you want to leave that place and people say, we did it, not somebody else did it. Like, when it is Westerners coming in and they take it less seriously, they don't own the work. So, pretty much, I think that's entirely changing in all organizations are trying to empower people, not just getting it done.
Yeah. What surprised you most about African Christianity? Did you get any theological arguments with anybody there?
One of the things that surprised me was they are very much like set in like conforming to one denomination. You know, like a missionary will go there from one denomination. Like in Malawi, Presbyterianism is huge. Like someone from the Presbyterian church comes and says, like, you know, this is the denomination you guys have to believe in. And I'm just like, what? Like, no, I'm a non-denominational Christian. Like, you know, I'm just someone who follows Jesus. Like, why do you have to follow a man who has an interpretation of how to do that? Like, you just have the Bible, you know? And they're just like, really? Like, that just kind of blew their mind. Wait, I'm like, have a label? I can just be, like, up with Jesus? It was really surprising how they just felt like they had to put themselves in a label and a box. I was like, no.
All right, who thinks they got the best question?
That guy.
He's got two arms.
It'd be really easy to sit here and rip apart your superstitions like punching your bags. That's what, you know, it's fun to do. But I think you guys, regardless of your differences of beliefs of all of us, radical people, I'm very excited that you did this, and I think it's super awesome. And so, you know, regardless of what we disagree about, end of the world or what the hell ever, I think it's awesome that you came here, and it was a great movie, and I feel like it was in line. So. Woo!
Like, he's a little restless, so we're gonna wrap up and thank you so much for coming.
Yeah, we'll be hanging out outside of the conference.